Simon & Schuster Audio presents Halo, Last Light by Troy Denning. Read by Scott Brick.
For Elena Hayday, bold, brave, and brainy. May your own adventures never require a BR-55. Chapter 1. 0832 hours, July 2nd, 2553, military calendar. Crime scene Charlie, 104 meters below ground. Montero Cave System, Campos Wilderness District, Planet Gao, Cordoba System. Special Inspector Veta Lopez had been raised to hate and fear everything about the United Nations Space Command, from its sheer might and criminal war practices to the murderous thugs it called Spartans. So it was only natural to assume that the serial killer stalking the Montero Cave System might be one of the power-armored hulks riding through the darkness with her now. Certainly the M.O. fit. The victims had all sustained injuries consistent with a large, mechanically enhanced attacker. Injuries such as crushed bones and disjoined limbs, ruptured organs, and collapsed skulls. But good investigators did not let their personal bias influence their thinking. They gathered evidence and weighed facts, and they let the theory of the crime build itself. So Veda would do what she always did. She would study the victims and establish a timeline for all 8 murders, then check it against the known locations of everyone in her suspect pool. She would catalog the weaknesses and habits of the remaining subjects and use that knowledge to put pressure on the perpetrator. Most of all, she would be patient and persistent, and she would keep pushing until the killer revealed himself. And if that killer turned out to be a towering Spartan in 400 kilos of Mjolnir armor, Veda would do what she always did. She would take him down. The cavern floor began to descend more steeply. Then the whine of the electric engines deepened as the rubber-tired tunnel weasel changed gears to keep from picking up speed. A moment later, the little tram entered a broad gallery illuminated by the platinum glow of work lamps. Like the rest of Montero Cave System, the gallery was hot, humid, and filled with mineral vapors, but its beautiful flowstone walls were bathed in a cold blue light that made them resemble frozen waterfalls. As the tunnel weasel came to a stop, a trio of UNSC Marines in black BDUs emerged from the shadows and approached. They exchanged salutes with a UNSC major seated next to Veda. Then an older Marine with bushy gray brows stepped forward to report.
Area secure, Major.
Thank you, Sergeant. The slender officer at Veda's side was Ira Halal, a black-haired, blue-eyed major sent by the UNSC Judge Advocate General's Corps to help investigate the murders. So far, he struck Veda as dedicated, intelligent, and reluctant to cooperate. Any unexpected visitors?
Sir, none that we detected.
The sergeant glanced around the perimeter of the gallery, then added, but the conditions down here wreak havoc with our motion sensors, and 22 passages open into this gallery. We couldn't watch them all every minute.
Halal nodded. Of course not, he said. It was a long shot anyway. I don't think this unsub is likely to return to the scene.
The sergeant frowned.
Unsub, sir?
Unknown subject of investigation, Veda clarified. She stepped out of the passenger compartment. And I want to check those passages, Major.
Halal turned to her.
To what purpose?
To look for evidence, of course. Veda paused, reminding herself to play nice, then added, I like to be thorough.
Halal did not quite roll his eyes.
Our resources are limited, Inspector Lopez, and so is our time. I suggest we focus on the crime scene and not waste our assets chasing phantoms. I don't chase phantoms, Major Halal. Veda stepped close. I catch killers. Quite a lot of them, actually. Halal held her gaze for a moment, then smirked. As you wish, Inspector. We'll do this your way. He ordered the Marines back to their posts, then turned toward the tunnel weasel, where Veda's four-member field team was unloading equipment from the third car. On the side of the car, the image of a stylized tree fern sprouted from the letters MVC, the logo of the Montero Vitality Center, from which the UNSC had commandeered the tram. Watching over Veda's team were three Spartans in their famous Mjolnir armor. With their blocky helmets and titanium alloy outer shells, the trio looked more like war robots than human beings. And from what Veda had read about their exploits in the public record, that might be close to the truth. There hadn't been enough detail for her profiler to suggest how their personalities might have been impacted by such a steady diet of fierce combat, but Veda suspected it wouldn't be good. Halal fixed his gaze on the Spartan leader. Lieutenant, have one of your Spartans secure the adjoining passages and report any evidence of observation. Actually, my team will be inspecting the passages. Veda interrupted. Whether Halal was trying to hide something or simply did not realize how often serial killers returned to the scene, she could not say. But either way, she was not about to trust any part of the investigation to him or the UNSC. You're welcome to send an observer, if you like. Inspector Lopez, these caverns are under military control, Halal said, and Spartans are well-trained observers. But they're not homicide investigators, Veda said, and military control didn't stop our killer from murdering at least 8 people down here. Since those people happen to be Gao citizens, and these caves happen to be located on Gao, their murders fall under the jurisdiction of the Gao Ministry of Protection, which makes this my investigation. Veda paused for emphasis, then continued, As I said, Major, you're welcome to send an observer. Halal sighed. We'll send a guard. He did not even bother to look at Veda as he spoke. The last thing I need is to lose someone from your team, too. Two? Veda asked. Has the UNSC been losing people? That's not what I meant, Halal said quickly. It's just procedure, in case the UNSUB is trying to keep an eye on the investigation. You just told the sergeant that you didn't think our UNSUB was likely to return to the scene. Halal shrugged. I could be wrong. He turned away, as though intent on watching Veda's team unload their gear. As I said, it's just procedure. Halal was lying, of course, and it seemed to Veda that he was worried about something even more dangerous than their UNSUB. But she could not imagine what that might be. The Montero cave system was the most visited natural wonder on Gao, a vast labyrinth of interconnected caverns spread beneath 1,000 square kilometers of jungle. It had an untold number of access points, including 38 major entrances operated by villages and private spas, and until the killings began, thousands of tourists had entered the caverns each month without encountering anything more hostile than a flight of irritated saurios. It would have been easy to blame the UNSC and look no further, but the truth was that strange things had been happening in the Montero region for a while. 2.5 months ago, a rare tumbler had shaken the entire region, leveling 2 villages and damaging several spas. Shortly afterward, tourists began to emerge from the caverns miraculously cured of lifelong ailments and terminal illnesses. The newsmongers quickly substantiated the claims, and sick people began to flood into the caves, hoping for their own miracles. Then, a month after the quake, a UNSC task force entered the Cordoba star system and requested permission to conduct research in the caverns. The common assumption was that Oni, the UNSC's notorious Office of Naval Intelligence, wanted to investigate the miracle cures. Gao's anti-centralization government denied the request. The task force insisted, and after a tense negotiation, President Aponte reluctantly granted permission to land a small research team. The small team turned into an entire battalion, which promptly occupied the region's most elegant spa and declared the entire cave system off-limits to everyone else. Predictably, the order inflamed Gao's fiercely independent citizens, and local guides began to sneak people into the caverns via hundreds of unmapped entrances. For a couple of weeks, the two sides pretended to ignore each other. Then tourists began to go missing.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.